I'm Dr. Sumam Chikki from Navodaya College of Physiotherapy, and today I'll be talking about asthma. And in this class, we'll be discussing the definition of asthma, its etiology and risk factors, the pathogenesis behind it, different types of asthma, their clinical features, diagnosis, treatment, and yes, of course, the PT management. So first, let's see what is asthma. Now, asthma is a chronic inflammatory condition of the airways in which we can see hyper-responsiveness of our airways to a wide range of stimuli that leads to bronchial inflammation. And it is associated with recurrent episodes of cough, wheezing, chest tightness, and breathlessness that are often worse at night or in early morning. So the airflow limitation is often reversible with treatment, but however, in case of some chronic asthma, the inflammation may be accompanied by an irreversible airflow limitation. Now, its etiology and the risk factors. So the exact cause of asthma, it remains obscure, but however, it's generally believed to result from a combination or an interaction between its genetic factors and the environmental factors. So first, the genetic factors, in which there are certain genes and their susceptibility to the disease, and it also shows some association with the family history. Next, the environmental factors, such as exposure to tobacco smoke, that increases and also worsens the condition. And there's also exposure to other triggering factors such as animal danders, dust, pollen grains, molds, etc. And we also have some other factors such as diet and nutrition, early antibiotic use, some atopic diseases like eczema and allergic rhinitis, and stress and occupational factors such as exposure to various chemicals, gases, irritants at a workplace. So these are usually seen in woodworking areas, in the industries, in bakeries, in car painting areas, and also in farming. Now I'm going to briefly explain the pathogenesis behind it. So due to this interaction between the genetic predisposition and the environmental exposure, there will be a cellular inflammation of the airways. And this leads to increase in the activity, the hyperactivity or abnormal activity of the bronchial cells, in which we can see constriction of the bronchial smooth muscles, which leads to bronchoconstrictions, and hyperplasia or hyperactivity of the goblet cells that leads to increase in mucus secretions. So all these things that it results in narrowing and obstruction of the airways, so because of which we can see symptoms like cough, breathlessness, chest tightness, and wheezes. Now moving on to next, we have different types of asthma. So this asthma, it can be classified based on the etiology, based on the degree of severity, and there are also some different clinical types of asthma. So first, based on etiology, it can be classified into atopic, also known as extrinsic, and non-atopic, also known as an intrinsic type of asthma. So first, talking about the atopic or an extrinsic type of asthma. So here, atopy is a genetic predisposition of an individual to produce a hyperreaction towards a normal allergen. So what happened here is an atopic individual is genetically predisposed to produce a hyperreaction towards a normal allergen. And it is known as extrinsic because the patient has to be exposed to some allergen like animal danders, pollen grains, dust, and all. So in this atopic asthma, it is seen in early years of life, and it shows some association with family history, and if you do those allergy tests, it will often be positive. Now next, the non-atopic or an intrinsic type of asthma. So here it is non-allergic. In this, the patient or an individual does not show any genetic predisposition to produce a hyperreaction towards a normal allergen. So it is something inside which is causing the problem. So it can be occupational induced, exercise induced, drug induced, or because of some cold. And unlike atopic asthma, here in the non-atopic, it does not show any family history, and it occurs in later years of life. And also, if you do those allergy tests, it'll be negative. And there is also a mixed type of asthma which shows a worsening symptom of both the atopic and non-atopic type of asthma. And next, now based on the degree of severity, it can be classified as grade 1, that is intermittent, grade 2, mild, grade 3, moderate, and grade 4, the severe type of asthma. Now let's see the different clinical types of asthma. So here we have episodic asthma, which means it occurs in episode. So there will be a symptom-free period that alternates with a presence of symptom period. And it can occur at any time. So there will be chest tightness, breathlessness, and wheezing, which are often expiratory and can be heard without the aid of stethoscope. And there will also be a troublesome cough with scanty viscid mucus. And in case of some severe episodes of episodic asthma, we can see tachycardia, pulsus paradoxus, and central sinusitis. And next, we have chronic asthma. So here, there is no period of symptom-free, or there's no symptom-free period. So it's very persistent and it occurs continuously. So there will be persistent coughing with mucoid sputum, persistent breathlessness and wheezing. And there will also be some recurrent episodes of respiratory infections. And next, there is childhood asthma, which often coexists with allergy and some atopic diseases. And then there is adult asthma. So the asthma in adults, they may have been persistent from their childhood, or it can be a relapse of an early childhood asthma, or it can be a true adult onset asthma with no signs and symptoms in the earlier life. So it's usually affected by non-allergic triggers such as drugs, and it can also be due to some occupational factors. And also sometimes the viral infections can also unmask the asthma. And next, we have a very important status asthmaticus. So this status asthmaticus is a severe form of asthma exacerbation. It refers to severe episodes of breathlessness and wheezing that last for more than 24 hours, and it is often unresponsive to the usual appropriate medications and therapy. So it is life-threatening, and it is also characterized by hypoxemia, hypercapnia, and secondary respiratory failure. Now let's see the clinical features of asthma. So of course we know there will be breathlessness, chest tightness, wheezing, and cough. But in case of some severe asthma, what we can see is decreased level of consciousness, and then there will be central sinuses in which we can see bluish discoloration of the lips and face, and there is rapid pulse and sweating. There will be use of accessory muscles like sternocleidomastoid and scalene muscles, and then the patient will often be gasping for air. So if the patient will not be able to complete a sentence because they'll often gasp. We will be gasping for air. So next, let's see how we diagnose it. So the diagnosis, it can be made based on the clinical features and the medical history. But however, there are diagnostic tests. So out of which, the most popular one is the pulmonary function test. So it is the single best test used to detect the airflow limitation. And it is done with the help of spirometer. So in this test, you measure two things. The first is FEV1, that is forced expiratory volume in 1 second, and FVC, that is forced vital capacity. So if you obtain a ratio of this FEV1 to FVC, you'll generally get a value that is 75 to 80%, which is a normal value. In case of asthmatic patient, the value will be lesser than 75 or 80%. And then there is also another test known as the methacholine challenge test. This is a provocative test which is used to detect whether the airways are reactive in nature or not. Now, if you see the name methacholine, so choline is a muscarinic agonist, which means it causes bronchoconstriction. So here, we'll have a patient breathe in a very small concentration of methacholine. Now, in case of asthmatic patient, what happens is their airways will respond to this methacholine. So there will be a significant bronchoconstriction. So if you perform a PFT after the methacholine challenge test, you will see 20% reduction in their FEV1 volume. than value than the normal original value. Then there is also another test known as the nitric oxide test. It's not widely available, but however, it measures the amount of nitric oxide available in your breath. So in case of asthmatic patient, you'll have a higher amount of nitric oxide level than the normal level. Now let's see the medical management. So you can remember this medical management with a mnemonic with asthma itself. So A, it stands for adrenergics. S is for the steroid. T, the theophylline. H, hydration. M is the oxygen max, and A is the anticholinergics. So if you see the drug therapy for the asthma, you have the relievers, which is the strong acting beta agonist, and then there is controllers, the long acting beta agonist, and then there are preventers, which usually consist of steroids. So these are all delivered through MDI, the meter dose inhalation method. So lastly, we'll see the physiotherapy management. So in this, we have breathing retraining techniques. So these breathing retraining techniques, they have more benefits on mild to moderate form of asthma. So in this, we have breathing exercises. So the main aim of breathing exercises is to normalize the breathing pattern. So, and this can be achieved by stabilizing the respiratory rate, whereby we adopt to a slower respiratory rate and increasing the expiratory airflow. And next we have taking in a smaller amount of breath, that is reducing the tidal volume. And then there is encouraging the nasal breathing, breathing through nose, and there's deep breathing exercises, which mainly includes diaphragmatic breathing, where you focus more on using your abdominal muscles and the lower thoracic movement. And then there is pursed lip breathing, and yes, there is something known as buccal breathing exercises, which is also a breathing retraining technique, but it is specific for reducing this hyperinflation and hyperventilation. It's developed by Dr. Buccal. So next we have inspiratory muscle training. The inspiratory muscles can be trained for both strength and endurance with the help of some external resistive devices. So increase in the strength of inspiratory muscles can reduce the intensity of dyspnea and can also improve exercise tolerance. Then there is physical exercise or physical training. With physical exercises, it reduces the symptom and can also improve your cardiopulmonary endurance and fitness. Then there are airway clearance techniques such as vibration, shaking, postural drainage, and some effective cuffing techniques to remove the secretions. So this is the end of the class. Thank you.